Not long ago, Caitlyn Jenner publicly denounced President Trump in the pages of the Washington Post, defying expectations one more time. Caitlyn Jenner, this week on Firing Line.
Firing Line with Margaret Hoover is made possible by the Robertson Foundation, Marlene Ricketts, the Asness Family Foundation, Daniel S. Loeb, the David Tepper Charitable Foundation, Inc., Spencer B. Haber. Corporate funding is provided by Stevens, Inc.
2015 was the year of Caitlyn Jenner. After her stunning public transition, receiving the ESPY's Arthur Ashe Courage Award, and becoming Glamour's Woman of the Year, Jenner's decision to reveal her authentic self was well received, even by those who had idolized Bruce for decades. In the 3 years since introducing herself as Caitlyn, ever the Olympian, she clears every hurdle of her renewed celebrity with ferocious determination and indomitable spirit. In becoming her authentic self, she's also found her passion, advocating for the rights and protections of trans people. But her controversial revelation that she is a Republican, which many in the LGBTQ community find irreconcilable with her desire to be one of their champions, has challenged her standing. Still, it is undeniable that coming out as a Republican has put her in the invaluable position to speak up for trans rights to those who need to hear it most, conservatives. I have seen this firsthand through my work with Ms. Jenner and the American Unity Fund, a conservative LGBTQ advocacy organization of which I am the president. Caitlyn Jenner, yay, welcome to Firing Line.
Margaret is the best.
We met
two and a half years ago, something like that.
I reached out to you because when you came out, not just as a trans woman, but as a Republican,
in my work
in the LGBT advocacy organization, right, recognized immediately that you were suddenly the most famous Republican in the world, but that also you might have a unique value proposition when it came to our advocacy issues. But before we get to that, the first thing I want to ask you about is, since 2015 and your amazingly public transition, the most high-profile transition of any trans person in history.
Right.
So I think what people would like to know to begin with is, now that you've been Caitlyn for 3 years, are you happy?
Oh my God. There's nothing better in life to wake up in the morning and just be yourself all day. I don't have any more secrets. I don't have to carry two suitcases, one for Bruce, one for Caitlyn. I don't have to sneak around. I don't have to lie to anybody. I just wake up in the morning and be myself all day. And it makes life so simple. But when I came out, I had never met another trans person. Mm-hmm. And boy, did I have a lot to learn. I had a lot to learn about the community, about the issues. Because honestly, I really didn't know anything. And sure, I made some mistakes, especially at the beginning when I thought, you know, my heart's in the right place. I got nothing but love in my heart. All I want to do is make it better for the next generation.
Well, I want to talk about that because when you transitioned, the people who knew you most and best were people who knew you as Bruce.
Right.
And the generation that is most familiar with LGBTQ issues are millennials and the Z generation, the people who are some of your youngest children's age.
Right.
They were, I think, predisposed to be favorable to this transition, but the majority of Americans who knew you previously and didn't know you from a reality TV show knew you from your iconic win in Montreal in 1976.
It was a good day.
They knew you from the big front of the Wheaties box, for example.
It was a good day. If you go back and look at the times, 1976, it was our country's bicentennial year. It was the highest rated Olympic Games of all time, barring none. I happened to come through with the performance that I was hoping for. Broke the world record that day. I am still very proud of those days.
There's something you've written about, and I've never asked you about this.
Okay.
Is that the next day, in the privacy of your own room in the Olympic Village, you stood in front of the mirror with your gold medal around your neck and thought what to yourself?
What did I just do?
Did you feel like you were living a lie?
Oh, I've always felt like I was living a lie. I thought to myself, what the hell did you just do? did you take this character and build this character up so big that you're stuck with him for the rest of your life? Because that really didn't represent me or who I am. And I thought, what am I going to do? And now this character's so big, I'm stuck with Bruce. And it was really scary and quite upsetting. And, you know, I thought about it a lot that day and then started building a career in television and in the entertainment industry and buried myself into work and then started raising children.
So fast forward, right before your book came out, you had said to me, you maybe said this to other people, that you looked back on all of your experiences that led you to the point where you were able to transition. It was not an easy...
What I have learned over the last 3 years is that everybody's journey is different in this community. And for so many years, I thought in the 80s I was going to transition. I thought I'm going to do this before I'm 40 because I don't want to be an old chick, you know, and I got to do this now. And got to 40 after being on hormones for 4.5 years, isolating myself from the world for 6 years, basically living in a house all by myself. I got to 39 and I couldn't do it. I just couldn't go any further. And about 5 months later, I met Chris when I decided I got to get back into life. I was honest with her, you know, and I'm sure I'm downplayed it at the time. And we hit it off. And for the next 23 years, we raised kids. But little Caitlyn was always still there. When I decided, when I finally got to the point in life where all my children were raised, Bruce had done just about everything. There wasn't much left for him to do. I had struggled with this my entire life and had my conversations with my children. I'm a person of faith, had my conversations with my pastor. I thought, okay, number one, you can't do it unless you know it's the right thing to do for you. To live your life authentically. You just don't even think about it unless you know that that is the right decision. But in doing that, maybe this is the reason kind of God put me on this earth, I felt, that for me to see if I can make a difference in the world, to see if I can bring this issue of probably one of the most discriminated parts of our society and the most marginalized part of our society, which is the trans community, and I can give you every statistic about murder rates, about suicide rates, and it's just horrible. How can I bring that into this spotlight to try to make a difference?
Now that you're your fully authentic self.
Here I am, yeah.
Yeah, you're also your full authentic political self. As we mentioned in the beginning, one of the most interesting moments for many people when you came out as trans was that you also announced that you were a Republican.
Mm-hmm.
Did you plan to do that?
No, I was actually asked the question, and boy, I found out that it was much easier to come out as trans than it was to come out as being a Republican.
Were you always a Republican?
Yeah, I've always been on the Republican side. Why? My dad fought in World War II. He landed on Omaha Beach. I love the military. I love a strong military. I like less government instead of more government. And... I like a freer market, less regulations. I look at as the American people built this country. The government didn't build this country. But on social issues, I've always been very progressive.
You're pro-choice?
Yeah. Pro-choice.
Pro-LGBT freedom?
I really didn't understand LGBT issues until after I transitioned.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I had a lot to learn there.
So you say that it was...
I am for marriage equality. I'm for LGBT rights. I'm for trans rights. I'm for everything, baby.
As you know, Firing Line was on the air for 33 years, and it was hosted by William F. Buckley, who had a very prominent conservative who came out and then came on Firing Line to talk about being gay and being conservative. And I'd like to get your reaction to what he says on Firing Line.
Okay.
While conservatives rallied around by their humanity and their decency and the fact that I'm one of them in politics and temperament, many radical gays thought me repugnant because I didn't announce I was HIV positive in 1988 as if it's anybody's business. The only really severe criticism I've gotten have been from people who said, well, how dare you not be one of us, which is the terrible stereotype that gay means left wing any more than then somehow straight automatically means conservative. You'd love it if it were the case, Bill, but as you know, a lot of heterosexuals are anything but conservative.
Does that feel familiar to you?
Yes, it feels very familiar. Yeah, things really haven't changed.
The backlash, is this the kind of backlash you got from the community for not being a liberal or a Democrat, presuming that because you are transgender, there's no way you could be a Republican?
Yes, exactly the same thing. And people think because you transition and you go through this that all of a sudden you're a different person. I am in so many ways just living my life comfortably, but in so many ways I'm still the same person. And it's the same with political views. I'm still the same, but today I just try to see if I can use that, if I can use my being on the inside to try to make a difference with the Republican Party. They need the most help. I get it. The Democrats do a better job when it comes to social issues. But the best thing that the Republican Party could do is stay economically conservative, to be conservative over here, but they have to be more progressive when it comes to social issues.
I want to ask you, was it easier to be a Republican when you were a white man than as a trans woman?
Yes. Much easier. Yeah. Yeah, nobody really questioned that. And then you move over, become a trans woman. But your political views, that's one thing about transition, okay, that people don't understand. And even I didn't understand when I first got it. People think that, oh, my God, you transitioned. Now you're going to, you know, all your views are going to change and you're going to enjoy different things and this and that. My views haven't changed. I just have learned a lot.
I mean, that's one of the criticisms of you is that the LGBTQ community, of which you've become an advocate, and you, I hear you talking about the economic struggles that trans women have, the safety struggles that especially trans women of color have. But the criticism of you is that you have all the privilege of a white, wealthy male and haven't had to endure the struggles or the challenges that trans women and trans people, especially on the economic side, have every day in terms of trying to afford hormones and get housing and keep their employment.
And I totally agree with them.
Yeah.
Okay? I agree. Okay? My transition is different. I have worked hard my entire life. Now, did I have male privilege, white male privilege to do that? Absolutely. I did. Okay? I admit that, okay? And that's one thing that a lot of people, I notice, have a hard time trying to grasp, that why would you leave all that strong, powerful, white male privilege, okay, and come over here to what society thinks is a weak female? Why would you give all that up to come over here? And my only answer is, that wasn't me over here. That's me over here, okay? That's where I come from. But it's also given me a platform. So I like to take those types of things and use my position to my advantage to help the community.
What I've observed with you is, in some ways, I think that you're a bit of a secret weapon for the trans community with Republicans, because the kind of person that you've been speaking to, elected officials in Washington, many of whom are men and many of whom are older, and didn't know any other trans person in their life, but they knew Bruce Jenner, or at least they believe they knew Bruce Jenner because everybody knew Bruce Jenner. And now they've seen your very public transition. You give them a touchstone for this thing called transgender people. What are you doing in Washington, D.C., and who are you talking to, and what are you trying to achieve?
Okay, most of the things that I do, okay, are very quiet.
Why are they quiet?
Because I want to keep an open communication with the people that I'm talking to. If I go in there and then I'm out promoting everything that I'm doing in Washington, D.C., I don't think they're going to talk to me next time.
So in other words,
I'd rather keep it quiet.
Are you talking to elected Republicans?
I have sat down with, I think it was like 15 evangelical Christian conservative Republican senators and congressmen, as we would call them in the LGBT community, the enemy, and sat down for 3 hours over dinner, talked about faith, talked about all the things that I've gone through, talked with them about all the issues. And because of that, I made a lot of alliances with a lot of people. Now, I'm not going to say who it is because I have open conversations with them that really have worked out very well. And in fact, I remember one of the senators goes, you know, when I was young and I was growing up and I saw what you did, I grew my hair out and, you know, wore kind of that Bruce Jenner haircut. And I thought, you know, it's just funny things like that happen. But because of that, I've opened up dialogue.
So can I just ask you, what kind of questions does a Republican senator or a Republican member of Congress ask you in private?
I don't think they just understand the issues. They see the trans community, I think, as a very marginalized community, and it is. They don't see there's the other side of the trans community. I've met trans women or trans men who have built tremendous companies once they transitioned. You know, once they get all that behind them, then they can kind of move on in life. They don't see how the trans community is also a very vibrant part of our society, vibrant part of the military. I think of Trump and some of the things that he's done over the last year, which has just been horrible. But he doesn't realize, you know, that he is the largest employer of trans people in the world.
Because he's the
commander-in-chief of the military. And we literally have thousands and thousands of people in the military who are trans. And he's also with the federal government. There are thousands of people in the federal government that are trans.
I want to get back to Donald Trump, but let me ask you first. As a emissary to Republicans on trans issues, is there a policy objective that you're trying to achieve?
Yes. This is what I want to do. We need hard legislation on the books for equality in this country. Recently in Utah, we just had probably a state, by the way, is a Republican legislature and a Republican governor put one of the best, most pro-LGBT legislation through.
And this is the fully comprehensive non-discrimination bill that was passed in Utah that it was actually trans-inclusive and protections to transgender
people. It was
people.
A big success for us. Also, New Hampshire, exactly the same thing.
And that was a Republican legislature and a Republican governor that added trans protections into their legislation.
Yes. And we need to do more of that.
So in the states, since 2015, there have been more than 300 laws that have been presented to legislatures that are anti-LGBT laws, but more than 111 anti-trans laws that have been considered at the state level. And I know you've been active in some states.
Yes.
Trying to connect and communicate with Republican legislators to defeat some of those bills.
Yes. I've been very active in that and working with the American Unity Fund to find out exactly where these things are going on. I've called governors. I've tweeted about things. I've gone places. In North Carolina, which was the most ridiculous thing.
And North Carolina, for our audience who doesn't know, passed a bill, HB2.
Yes,
which HB2. Prevented trans people from being able to use the bathroom of the identity that they identify as every day, forcing them to use the bathroom.
That says what's on their birth certificate, which is ridiculous.
Why is that so ridiculous? How do you explain that to people? When you go talk to Republican legislators, how do you explain that to them?
I say, look, first of all, there are trans people in your community. We need to protect them as much as we do anybody else. You look at these young trans people, especially like trans girls and stuff like that, who are 12, 13 years old, and we're going to tell them that they have to use the men's room, okay? It's just not going to work. Or a trans guy, the exact same thing, not causing any problems. Trans people do not cause problems in bathrooms. This is mostly about the teachers or the parents that don't know anything about this issue. The kids are fine. They could care less. Trans people are not going in and causing any problems.
Yeah. You have mentioned Donald Trump twice so far. And you had felt that of the Republican candidates who were running for president, that there was a chance that he might not be the worst on LGBT issues.
I did at first, yes. There was a girl, Jenna Telkova, at the Miss Universe pageant, which he owned. Jenna was a trans girl. She was in the Miss Canada pageant. He totally supported her.
He allowed her to compete as a woman, and there was some question about this at the time.
Absolutely. Very good for our community. During the convention, he was the first Republican ever to mention LGBTQ on the podium, to by far what I thought was one of the most rousing applause by all the people there. It was a huge applause. I thought, this is good. Yeah. Okay, this is good. Honestly, I don't know what happened when he got in there. Next thing you know, 3 months after he's in there, he did the Title IX thing.
For the sake of our audience, just in case they don't know what happened, there had been protections and guidelines issued by the Department of Education and the Department of Justice that had been put in place by the Obama administration.
Yes.
And
which was a good thing.
It was, in your view, it was a good thing because it gave guidance to teachers and school districts across the country about how to handle transgender students.
Right.
And one of the first things you noticed and one of the first things that happened definitively is that Jeff Sessions and Donald Trump
at a meeting
rolled back that guideline.
And I was furious. And why would they do something like that? I just could not figure out.
So that was the first thing for you that made you recognize that the Trump administration might not be friendly to LGBT people.
And was very openly...
How did you hear about that meeting?
Well, because he tweeted about it the next day, and then I started calling people and found out what was going on.
Donald Trump did something else on social media. He announced that he was going to kick out transgender military members.
I was furious. I said, how can you do this?
What'd you do? Did you say that to him? What'd you do about it?
Well, the first thing I did is I started doing social media about this is absolutely wrong. I'm a huge supporter of the military. They volunteer to do this. They volunteer to go out there and protect me. In the trans community, we have a big problem with job discrimination, okay? Happens all the time. I look at when the federal government says trans people can't be in the military, that works its way down. So it just makes the job discrimination side of it, not only just the housing and this and that, but the job discrimination really works its way down. It makes it more and more difficult for trans people.
It seems to me Donald Trump cares so much about celebrity. Do you think, because he cares about celebrity, that hearing somebody advocate on behalf of trans issues from Caitlyn Jenner maybe has more sway over him than somebody who's not as famous as you are?
I certainly would hope so. And I work on those things, okay?
Did you express your dissatisfaction with the trans military ban?
Oh, yes.
You talked to Donald Trump about the trans military ban.
I cannot say, I will not say or decline, because I keep those conversations very private. But either posting on social media, because I went after him big time on social media, he certainly knows how I feel.
Can you tell us whether he's responded personally to you?
No, I'm not going to say, because I keep all my conversations very quiet, because that's the way I work. At a point, see, this is what we need, and I can't say this. I'll say this 10 times on your show, okay? Is we need hard legislation on the books, not presidential mandates. I want equality on the books. If you're an American citizen, everybody's equal.
Do you feel like with some of the most religious conservatives that you've spoken with that are also in possessions of elected authority, that even if you haven't changed their minds, you've opened their eyes?
In some cases, yes. In some cases, no. Mike Pence, when he was in Indiana, had some of the most anti-LGBT legislation out there. So I go up to Mike Pence and I tell him my little story about how I was in town and I talked to all of these evangelical Christians and I basically said, I would love to have that conversation with you.
What did he say?
He says, you know what? I would love that. I even turned to his wife and I said, I would love to have you part of that conversation. And she said to me, don't you worry, I'll be there. And I said, okay, I'm in. For almost 2 years, a year and a half, we tried to have that meeting and never gotten it. And it shows what we're up against, you know? This is not gonna be an easy fight. I feel like we're 30 years behind the LGB side of the community. They've learned, and you know what? You have to learn a lot from them. They never stop fighting. Let's take marriage equality. They never stop fighting. Every time they lost something, they went right back into court. And they just kept fighting, till eventually the public came around. And as far as trans issues, I think that's the same thing. I'm gonna keep fighting for our community. I'm gonna keep trying to help out the best I possibly can. And in doing that, eventually, the rest of the population will come around, especially as the next generation comes up.
So, even Mike Pence?
No, but he'll be gone. We just have to outwait him. Honestly, I would hope he would come around.
There's hope for everyone.
I would hope he would come around. Honestly, I would like to spend more time with him. I am not one who, somebody who doesn't like you or this and that, oh, I'm gonna shy away from that. No, I'm right there. Yeah, I'm right in their face. Kill them with kindness. Mike Pence would love me.
Caitlyn Jenner, thank you for coming to Firing Line and sharing your activism and your views.
And you know what? We'll work together and we'll make a difference.
Firing Line with Margaret Hoover is made possible by the Robertson Foundation, Marlene Ricketts, the Asness Family Foundation, Daniel S. Loeb, the David Tepper Charitable Foundation, Inc., Spencer B. Haber. Corporate funding is provided by Stevens, Inc.
You're watching PBS.